shows you the entire world. You can see here we have Europe. You've got Africa. We can kind of go around here and have a look, and it will show you a lot of places in that. Some areas will have more detail than the than others, as we will kind of go into, but I guess the main aim of it from Google is to basically be able to map the world. It's completely free. There's no cost associated with it, and they've added in some cool new features into it as well. So you can see at the minute my little red pin here is on London, because for those who don't know, that's where I live. And I kind of selected London and places of interest. So let's kind of zoom in a little bit as we go down here, and you can see this is Greater London, kind of around here. The M25 is kind of like the border of London-ish, although it kind of, you could argue that sometimes it expands even further around. You can kind of see that London, very much the hub of the UK, all the roads kind of leading out, and I guess towards it as well. I was actually born around this area here, and lived most of my life around this area, which is a really nice area. You can see the South Downs National Park, a very, very kind of beautiful section of the UK as well. And when you kind of look at like Google Maps, it kind of lets you, you kind of think like how close bits of things are. Like, I never really thought about how close the UK actually is really to France, because we're in, on an island. It always feels a little bit, you kind of feel like out on your own, but it's really not. And obviously we've got Northern Ireland, Ireland, Scotland, and Scandinavia and things like that around as well. Super kind of cool as well. And we can kind of zoom in here, and we can keep zooming in. This is the really cool thing about it. So for like major cities, in here you can kind of keep zooming, keep zooming, keep zooming, keep zooming, and they now have this kind of like 3D style of map as well, which is kind of freaky when you think about it. Like the attention, like this is all kind of like mapped. So, you know, if you I don't think they have people in it, but you can see like a building site here. I was watching somebody like talk about it, and they were saying in their house they could see their patio furniture out on it, which is kind of freaky, but gives you this amazing kind of like view, I guess, of London. Or just, you know, major cities in general will have it. So, you know, if you live in a city, then you, chances are you will have this kind of like 3D view as well. But the thing kind of was getting me taught here was the London Eye, because I've got it on kind of like London landmarks. I thought we could have a look at them and see in particular. So this is it's called London Eye, called the Coca-Cola London Eye, but it's changed its like sponsorship over the years. It was built for, in kind of like, because of the millennium basically. We had a few things built in London because of that, the dome as well, I guess, is probably a famous thing. And this is, I think it's the biggest Ferris wheel in the world, or at least it was when it was built. It may since have been beaten, I think, but it does offer like a fantastic view of London. You could probably kind of see the kind of view there. You've got the Houses of Parliament just over there as well. This is Waterloo around here. It's kind of so weird when you kind of look at this and you're like, yeah, I've kind of walked all around here, you know, done all those sort of things. Been along a train along there. It's very freaky actually. So you have 10 Downing Street just there as well. So this is kind of like Westminster around here. London Eye. I've actually been on it. I hated every second of it because I'm terrified of heights. You may be asking, like, why did you go on it? Well, I don't know. It's just one of those things you've got to do, I guess, isn't it? But yeah, it goes really slowly. I can't remember exactly how long it takes to do a rotation, but it's probably like under half an hour, but it goes very slowly around. God forbid as well you ever got stuck. That would be pretty horrific. So yeah, that's landmark number one. I don't know what these landmarks are in London, so I guess it will. Okay, the Tower of London. Yeah, that's a pretty famous landmark. The Tower of London used to be this kind of like a very what would be the word, I guess, brutal kind of maximum security prison, I guess, where all the kind of during the kind of Victorian era and before that, it was used for you know, all the traitors and things like that would be sent to the Tower of London. Nowadays it's just a tourist attraction. There's no actual prisoners held inside there. It does hold the crown jewels, which are, you know, the, I guess, the famous jewel and, you know, crown and scepter of the Queen of England. And it's well known for its beefeaters and its ravens as well. Around, it's just one of those kind of like touristy things, tourist attraction type things, basically. It's pretty cool if you do go there. It can be pretty gruesome as well, kind of like the way people used to get tortured and things like that, locked away in here for, you know, makes you realise that, well, at least in this country anyway, the justice system is actually a good thing, as much as people may moan about it nowadays. But it's also like just one of those kind of like magnificent looking, you know, back in the kind of like the era that I guess these buildings were built, like, I think this was obviously pre-Victorian era, but you kind of think of it like around then. But the buildings were, they just had this, you know, even something like a prison or something like that would have this just majestic look to them and this amazing kind of like design, whereas obviously nowadays we tend to just build like buildings of glass and steel and things like that. But it's kind of like, you can see like in London, it's just this fusion of this very old kind of historical you know, places, and then these brand new kind of like glass and steel buildings, you know, not necessarily skyscrapers. We don't really do skyscrapers, but pretty tall buildings anyway. So what's next? St Paul's Cathedral. Here we have it. If you've played Assassin's Creed Syndicate, you probably would have climbed St Paul's Cathedral on here. Very kind of beautiful cathedral, amazingly, like, I think it was undamaged during World War II, or at least, shall we say, survived World War II, despite heavily bombed in and around London, like during the Blitz and things like that as well. But St Paul's Cathedral is where they hold a lot of like state funerals and weddings and things like that. You know, it's seen as like, I wouldn't necessarily say like the, I guess it's seen as like the main cathedral of London, if you like. So it's seen as probably, definitely I'd say, the most famous cathedral in the UK. What's the difference between a cathedral and a church? I have literally no idea. But cathedrals generally tend to be bigger, don't they? I could probably tell you what the difference is in civilization, but the game, that is. But I don't know in real life, I'm afraid. And up next, Buckingham Palace. Most people, I guess, would know Buckingham Palace as the residence of the Queen of England. It's obviously a major tourist attraction. Regent's Park's the one I probably go to most, because it's the one which I wouldn't necessarily say is local to me, but it's definitely the easiest to get to. I live only about 20-25 minutes away from Regent's Park, so no, I'm not going to show you where I live, by the way. I live there, so I generally go there, but there are some really nice parks, Hyde Park, Green Park, St James's, Battersea. But as I say, Regent's Park generally tends to be the one I go to, and quite often when I, like, especially when it's a nice day, I usually get like a bus home from work, but I would like get off the bus kind of round about Regent's Park and then just kind of like walk through it and stuff like that. It's just nice. Or I can sometimes even kind of walk around it as well. Obviously pretty busy during a nice day, but never, I've been there on even like some really really hot days, it never feels overcrowded, which is kind of nice as well. But anyway, Buckingham Palace, and it's kind of cool, it kind of almost feels like a watercolour picture when you kind of zoom in this far as well, doesn't it? I guess you're not really meant to zoom in that close really to get any sort of like, it doesn't give you that much detail. But yeah, Buckingham Palace, obviously they've removed the people because there would usually be like hundreds and hundreds of people around here just taking photos and things like that, I guess. The Queen, and I guess Buckingham Palace is her main residence. She does have, you know, different residences across the UK, which she frequents. As well, but Buckingham Palace obviously the kind of what's known as the main one, and I guess what used to be really the main seat of power within the UK back when we were actually ruled by monarchy, rather than what it actually is nowadays. So that's pretty cool. Okay, what have we got next? Tower Bridge. Now, Tower Bridge, often people call this London Bridge. Just check one thing, yep, there we go. Let's check we were recording. People often call this London Bridge because that's what they think London Bridge is, but it isn't actually London Bridge, it's Tower Bridge. Kind of a pretty cool bridge. It's got the, if I can just kind of zoom around, so it flips up here, so it does still raise and lower to this day, and it doesn't do it on as regular basis as it would have done it in the past, but it does still raise and lower. So this is kind of like a drawbridge, so that will raise that way, that will raise that way, so boats can come through pretty well. And I believe like nowadays there's even people who still live in like here who look after the bridge and do all that sort of thing. At least that was how it used to be. I don't know if it still literally is to this day. That's quite an exclusive place to live if you do actually happen to live there. You can just see the Shard over here. That's the tallest building in London currently, as well. It's kind of like office and housing. But it's also like you can, it's like a tourist attraction, so you can go to the top and get a view across London if you are so inclined to do that, but I am most definitely not inclined to do that. Westminster Abbey. So Westminster Abbey is actually where I kind of talked about St Paul's weddings, but I think actually Westminster Abbey is where a lot of the royalty get married and things like that as well. Again, kind of pretty beautiful building. What's the difference have no idea. But yeah, there. You can see Big Ben in the background there, which is pretty cool. Actually, that looks pretty decent from here. And obviously the Houses of Parliament and things like that. It kind of feels a bit eerie as well when you kind of see this, and I guess you can see remnants of traffic on the roads, but like you can't see people because there would be just like so many people around here. But yeah, this is like the government offices basically, that you would see. So obviously you've got 10 Downing Street, which is where the Prime Minister lives. It's kind of interesting when you think about it. You know, you think about most countries, the leader of that country, whether it's America or even like just other countries, they generally live in quite a grand palace almost, or you know, the White House is obviously this huge building, but 10 Downing Street's literally like a terrace house. And I think it's the Chancellor, yeah, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, usually lives in number 11, and the Chancellor of the Exchequer basically being like the, I don't know, how would you describe the Chancellor of the Exchequer? They look after the money side of things, I guess, for the ruling like party of that time. They deal with all the budget and things like that. Actually, I think it might have been when Tony Blair was in charge. I can't remember. It could have even been David Cameron, but one of them didn't actually live in 10 Downing Street. They lived in, I think, number 11 because it was bigger and they had a lot of kids. Can't quite remember which one it was because they both had quite a lot of kids, both Tony Blair and David Cameron. I think it might have been David Cameron, which was like the first time in ages that the Prime Minister hadn't actually lived in 10 Downing Street, but they did kind of like all their business in 10 Downing Street, if that makes sense. That kind of sounds like he goes to the toilet in 10 Downing Street, but what I mean is that obviously that it's still like the significant kind of base of operations, shall we say, of the government, number 10 Downing Street. Just yesterday, Theresa May, our current Prime Minister, she announced just outside 10 Downing Street that we would be holding a snap general election. So in other words, we obviously have general elections every 4 years, but they can, you know, with obviously as long as the Parliament votes on it, can hold general elections whenever they want, basically. A lot of people have mixed feelings on that, personally. I don't really mind either way. The one thing I guess you could argue is that Theresa May is not technically an elected Prime Minister. It's different, I guess, to, a little bit anyway, to say if you're from America where you vote for a president and then you also vote for like senators as well. In the UK, to really very simplify things, you vote for like parties, I guess, and you know, in your area, and then they make up the government, and then the kind of majority party is the one that rules. But whereas I think like the Senate and like the President are kind of like separate things in the UK, they're combined almost with the Prime Minister. It's kind of a slightly different role, and when David Cameron resigned, the party held a leadership contest which Theresa May won, and therefore she became the Prime Minister, you know, the leader of the party, therefore the leader of the ruling party in the UK. I guess technically you could argue that she's not an elected like leader, as a way, So, for example, Donald Trump was to step down and Mike Pence was to take over, you know, people might argue that he's not an elected leader of the country. But obviously, it kind of is in a way, if that makes sense. Without wanting to get too deep into politics, I guess that's a very, 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 very simplified, probably very flawed way of looking at it. But I guess with the election, at least, people who say may have voted for Conservatives under a previous leader and may not like the new leader, or maybe people who have voted for other parties but because they didn't like the leader of the Conservative Party, the previous leader, David Cameron, may well like the new leader and therefore may well vote for him. So I guess in a way it's democracy in action. But yeah, so that's the kind of I guess seat of power of the UK, I guess, around here. Big Ben, I had a feeling we might be going here at some point. Big Ben is obviously pretty world famous. When people think of London, they think of Big Ben, don't they? The House of Parliament. Now, people think that this is actually Big Ben here, this building. It's not, it's the bell inside the building. It's called Big Ben, which chimes out every hour as well. And we have the House of Parliament. We have the House of Commons, which is the ruling kind of elected MPs. And we have the House of Lords, which are like, I guess lords are either granted titles or inherited, and the House of Lords doesn't really have much power within the UK. It used to. Back in the olden days, the Commons used to be less powerful and the Lords used to be more powerful, but now it's switched over. I guess you could argue that's slightly better, to have elected officials by people. You know, that's how democracy runs, rather than inherited titles making decisions on the fate of the country. So yeah, that's kind of the way it works, I guess. And yeah, Big Ben as well. It's kind of a, if you've played Assassin's Creed Syndicate, chances are you've probably climbed up here as well at some point. Looks pretty, I think it does look pretty different actually to how it did look in Assassin's Creed. Obviously a lot less cars in Assassin's Creed. And the River Thames is way busier than it is currently. And by the way, it's called Thames, not Thames. Even seen people in the UK like mispronounce that. At the British Museum, which is an amazing place actually. It's a museum. That's, you know, but it's like one of the largest museums in the world, and totally free entry as well. And it honestly has just this amazing collection of historical artifacts within it. It's really, like, if you're in London, it's well worth checking out the British Museum. Absolutely amazing. I think they were like, I think I read somewhere that they were like mapping the British Museum in Minecraft or something like that, and they were going to like, so for it's kind of like a weird thing I guess to do, but yeah, very very cool. Where are we going next? The Palace of Westminster. It's kind of back to the House of the Parliament, I guess. It's like the kind of like meeting place for the in-between place of the Commons and Lords, as I said. I think technically, like, the Lords does have the power to veto things in the House of Commons. So the way like bills are passed is like they're kind of voted for in the House of Commons and they go to the House of Lords, which has always been the tradition. But I think most of the time the Lords stay out of things. Sometimes, occasionally, they do get involved, but most of the time they stay out of it, I think. And then it goes to the Queen and she has to sign off. Now, I don't remember, like, in the time of our current Queen, at least when I've been alive, the Queen's ever, like, used what is technically now ceremonial powers to kind of, like, London Dungeon over here as well, which is a kind of tourist attraction. And oh look, Shrek's Adventure as well. I've not seen that, but I've not been there myself. I'm sure that's great. But the London Dungeon's pretty cool. It's kind of goes back to the like medieval Dark Ages sort of thing, where things were, shall we say, not quite as civilized as they currently are. Although if you've been out in London on a Saturday night, you might disagree with me there. But yeah, it's a pretty cool tourist attraction though, actually. If you kind of like that sort of gruesome-y thing, I've been there and it is pretty cool. Kensington Palace. Now Kensington Palace, I think, yeah, it's one of the royal residences. As you can see, it's probably a little bit more out of the way than Buckingham Palace. Probably not as many tourists. I was going to say, I think that's where Prince Charles is, but that's actually Kensington Palace, I think. No, God, St. James's Palace, sorry. So many palaces, so confusing. But yeah, this is in Hyde Park, which is another really nice nice park. And as you can see, not really too far away from Buckingham Palace in the whole shape of things. That would probably take you about 45 minutes to walk, I think. Yeah, probably about that. So not really. Why do you need so many palaces, eh? Good question. I think here we can see, like, is this where it stops? Yeah, that's where it stops being 3D. So as I say, there are limits to the 3D, but I think they have like Tokyo and like a lot of other cities 3D at the minute. A Tate Modern. So this is more of a kind of modern attraction, I guess, as the name suggests, within the UK, which is kind of like a modern art museum, well worth going to see as well. This is the Millennium Bridge, which links to it. A bridge built, like, because, as I said, because the wheel was also a Millennium thing. The bridge also as well. It's Tate Modern is pretty cool. The Millennium Bridge actually came when it was first built. It had a lot of issues with vibrations that you can kind of see here, but it's kind of got these. It's kind of like a weird suspension bridge design, and apparently when it first was designed, it wasn't quite tuned right, and because it was getting so much traffic, and apparently because they were walking, like when you get a lot of people together walking, they walk in rhythm, just as a natural thing, and it was causing quite a lot of sway and shake on the bridge, and people were getting a little bit nauseous because of it. But apparently they fixed that, and it also probably doesn't get as much traffic anymore, because, you know, 17 years since it was built. It's not quite the tourist attraction it probably was. Look at that, it's like a little garden on top of the train station there. That's pretty cool, not seen that before. But yeah, Tate Modern's pretty cool. So it has loads of like modern art, and crane is probably gonna fall down at any moment. But yeah, loads of modern art exhibitions and things like that in there. It's a pretty cool place to go to. Probably like made famous for things like Damien Hirst, who like chops an animal in half and puts in formaldehyde and stuff like that. So if you're into that sort of thing, then that's cool. But if more like me and you're into this sort of thing, which is the Natural History Museum, then this is another fantastic. This and the British Museum, like two of my favourite places in London. The problem with the Natural History Museum is like a horrible, like as it sounds, and the British Museum in a way, but they're so busy all the time. They really are, because they're so good. But the Natural History Museum is amazing. So this deals with the British Museum generally tends to deal with kind of like man-made kind of things, I guess you would argue. The Natural History Museum obviously deals with nature, so it's got a lot of, like, I guess it's famous for things like dinosaur exhibitions and stuff like that, but it does a lot more than that, and honestly a fascinating place to go to and see. And again, like a real kind of like must see if you're in and around London. I think a lot of people have kind of like been there, but yeah, really cool place to go. As I say, pretty busy most of the time. I think that's like the tube station there, I seem to remember. Trafalgar Square. That is Nelson's Column right there, which a lot of people know. Actually, I'm going to say, not great details, not terrible. But National Gallery, again, like, in real life, there are thousands of people around here on any day. But the National Gallery is the art gallery, so it has a lot of very famous artists. You see things like Van Gogh, Picasso, things like that in there. Again, totally free to go to as well. And I've been there and had, like, you can get like these like headphones, and when you go to like a different picture, you can just like type in a number and it'll tell you all about it and stuff like that. It's really cool if you just kind of want to wander around on your own, which I have done. No, I don't think that's sad. We've got where is whereabouts? Ah, okay. So that's Piccadilly Circus here. Piccadilly Circus is very famous for the kind of giant billboard. I didn't really think it's as impressive. It's more iconic. It's not really that impressive anymore. And then that's Regent Street here. And then that will come up to Oxford Street, which is here. That's Oxford Circus. You can see the buses. It kind of does look like it's a little post-apocalyptic when you kind of see this, doesn't it, in a way. But that's Oxford Street there. And we have, so where is Leicester Square? I'm probably like totally screwing this up. Oh, it's here. God, you know what, I'm an idiot, because so I actually used to work in Leicester Square as well, but don't normally see the trees in full bloom like this, so it's kind of weird. Leicester Square is quite famous for its cinemas and premieres of films and things like that. And yeah, that's Trafalgar Square as well. And you've got Admiral Nelson, who looks out to sea as well. Nelson's Column features Admiral Nelson, who was England's greatest kind of like naval officer, died in the Battle of Trafalgar. At Trafalgar Square, where he defeated the Spanish or French, one of the two, can't quite remember. But he also lost an eye and lost an arm in previous battles as well. But he was definitely one of those almost singular people who changed the course of history by himself, who, if it wasn't for his kind of like strategic naval knowledge and leadership, things probably would have been very different in like English history. Hyde Park here as well. We've kind of already seen Hyde Park, haven't we? Because again, Kensington Palace. You have the Princess Diana Memorial Fountain just there. Sea Life Centre. I kind of feel it's a little bit weird to have the Sea Life Centre there on the Thames, because there's not a lot of sea life going on in the Thames. As you see here, you might think, like, oh, why is it brown? Like, it's not actually brown, it's just the way it looks. It's not actually, like, a really nice colour either, but it's a lot less polluted than it used to be. Victoria and Albert Museum. This is actually a pretty cool museum as well, if you're into, like, kind of art and fashion and design and things like that. The Victoria and Albert Museum is actually really interesting. It features kind of like a lot of historical, it's named after Queen Victoria and her husband Prince Albert, and yeah, it kind of features like, I guess it's a design museum in a way, but it also features kind of modern and a lot of things from the past as well. It's a pretty cool place to go to, actually. I think I don't know if Hungerford Bridge, I've actually never even been here, I don't think, probably. I think that's scraping the barrel a bit on a landmark. London Zoo, though, that's cool. London Zoo's in Regent's Park. That's a really, really cool zoo to go to. Actually, they do a lot of conservation stuff there. Whatever your view on zoos are, whether you think they're correct or not, it's one of the good guys, I think, in terms of zoos. They do, like I say, a lot of conservation work, and from what I've seen, anyway, they do treat their animals pretty darn well. and they have super cool penguins as well. If you go there, Churchill War Rooms. So these are like a museum around, obviously, World War II. And there we are, back to London as a whole. So there we have it. It's a little tour. So as you can see, they're kind of like really cool things, I think. I might do some more videos depending on how people like things like this, I guess, on like different places around the world, because like I know stuff about London, I live here and seen things, but there's loads of places around the world which I just don't know, and they have things like this Voyager now where you can go on tours basically, kind of a little bit like we just did there, and that's I think really cool. Different things around travel, nature, culture, history. So yeah, and this is all free, so yeah, there you go. But there's the UK as a whole, and there's the world again. So yeah, thanks a lot for watching, guys, as always. It's been my pleasure. I'll catch you.